thank you for clicking on my video. Today we are going to install Ubuntu and we're going to learn a few things and only the most important things about Ubuntu. The first thing we're going to do, we're going to install Ubuntu. As of right now, the latest Ubuntu is Ubuntu 24.04. Open your favorite browser and search Ubuntu operating system. Click on the first link. Accept all cookies. Download Ubuntu. And download Ubuntu 24.04 LTS. I will cancel the download because I had already downloaded Ubuntu. So open another tab and search for VirtualBox. And depending on your operating system, I run Windows, so I will install VirtualBox for Windows hosts. I will cancel the download since I already downloaded and installed VirtualBox. After installing VirtualBox, open it. You will have a bunch of empty machines. I have a bunch of three machines. You will have no machines. So we are going to install Ubuntu. After clicking new, name of your Ubuntu virtual machine should be anything, so I will name mine Ubuntu. Make sure type is Linux and the version is Ubuntu 64-bit. Click on next. Do not reduce the base memory. You can only increase it. When you reduce the base memory, you will have problems installing Ubuntu. So I will increase the base memory slightly. Ensure the processor is within the green part. It should not cross the red part. Then click on next. Finish. So click on settings and go to video memory, display video memory. This ensures that your Ubuntu runs smoothly and make sure vivid video memory is maximum. And then go to, when you go to general, advanced, and general advanced, share the clipboard, make it bidirectional, drag and drop bidirectional. This will enable you copy paste between guest and host. Go to storage and on this click here and navigate to where your Ubuntu image is. I have downloaded Ubuntu a couple number of times, so I usually get the Ubuntu image suggested, so I'll just click on it from the drop down. But for new people, you have to navigate to where your Ubuntu ISO file is installed. So start your virtual machine. It may take a while if you're not used to it, but we are patient and we have the time. Click on enter. Now, when you get this screen, you're going to click on install Ubuntu. I've sped up the video so that it doesn't take a lot of time. There are basic questions here that I'm sure you can navigate easily. Then we have updates and software. I will uncheck downloads updates while installing Ubuntu because I intend my installation to take less time, so I will uncheck it. And I will leave install third-party software so that I can be able to easily use Ubuntu. It will be able to easily use Ubuntu as a beginner. So I'll click on continue. Then I'll click on erase disk and install Ubuntu. Continue. Here we have the location. Click check your location and continue. Input your name. I like short passwords for easy remembrance. I suggest if it's your first time, just use a short password or something that you can easily remember. Now my Ubuntu installation is complete. I will go ahead and restart my Ubuntu. Press enter when you see this screen. And now my Ubuntu machine is installed. Now the first thing that we're going to do, we're going to make Ubuntu full screen. To make our terminal, here we have what we call a terminal, where we use terminals in Ubuntu. So we're going to input the command clear and make our terminal clear. Our network is not working, so we are going to restart our network manager service using this command. You can still run this command even though if your network is working. It uses network from the host machine in a form of Ethernet. You can see my network is back. So the first thing you're going to do, you're going to make Ubuntu full screen. So we are going to begin by updating our Ubuntu. And then we'll go ahead and install Linux headers after the update is complete. So we'll do that with sudo apt install build essential DKMS Linux headers. $uname -r. Enter. Press Y for yes. Now the next thing you're going to do is we are going to go to the devices, then insert guest addition CD image. You will see this disk image, click on it. Then in this tab, right click and open in terminal. So we are going to run the script called autorun.sh, and the way we run script by /autorun.sh. It should be autorun.sh. Press enter, input your password. And wait for it to complete. Once done, press enter, and then reboot your Ubuntu virtual machine. Now you'll be able to see that your Ubuntu is able to be full screen. To make it completely full screen from VirtualBox, press right control plus F. So in this part you're going to learn a few basic commands about Ubuntu. The first command that you're going to learn is ls. Ls just lists all the file and the directories in a given folder or in the current directory. Right now we are in the root directory, and you can see how some folders in blue and some files in other colors. So to open a folder, you can see we have the folder named pictures. To open the folder pictures, you're going to do cd. Use cd to open the folder pictures and to go into the folder pictures. So you do cd pictures, press enter. Then we can do ls to list all the files in the current folder pictures. We can see how the screenshots folder in the pictures folder. Now let's open the screenshots folder. We can do that using cd command, cd screenshots. So what cd just does, it opens the folder. Ls lists all the files and folders in the current directory. So you can see we have an image, a screenshot image in the screenshots folder. Let's go ahead and open this screenshots image. To open and to view this screenshots image, you can use this command xdg open. You can use xdg open to open screenshots and to open images, and sometimes even video files, though I'm not really sure about that. You can give it a try. So xdg open, I usually like to copy so that I can get the correct file name. I copy it, then I paste it. Then we will be able to view the screenshots, the screenshot. Okay. Now we are able to see the screenshot that I had taken of my home screen. So we have learned ls command for listing, cd command for opening folders, and xdg open command for viewing images. Then there's another command that I want you to learn, and that is pwd, and that's just the path command. It lists the current path. So right now we are at the home Haggai pictures. That's our path, the current path. Then we have the clear command that just clears everything from the terminal. Ls to list. We're going to learn another command called rm. Rm command is just like the delete command. Okay, not the rm command, but the mkdir. Mkdir command just creates a new directory. So we can do sudo mkdir. Then after that, we state the directory name. So here we are going to create a directory called screen record folder. We're going to create a folder called screen record folder. In the current path, press enter, input your password and enter. So we're going to do ls to see if we have if the directory has been created. Now you can see the screen recorder folder has been created, and you also have a screenshot that was there previously. The next thing that you're going to do, we are going to learn about the rm command, which is basically the delete command. It enables you delete files. So to delete this screenshot, I'm going to do sudo rm. Then I'm going to copy the name. I'm going to copy the name of the screenshot. Then I will paste it. Then I press enter. And when I do ls, we can see that the screenshot is no longer available in the current path, meaning that it has been deleted. You should be very careful with the rm command, because you can delete very important files and document easily. To remove or delete a folder, we use the rm minus r command. So for files, we just use rm, and for folders, we use the rm minus r command. Then we copy the name of the folder and paste there. Then you press enter. And when you do ls to list all the files in the current directory, we see that there's no files because we have just deleted them. You can also do cd to go back to the root folder or the home folder. We just use cd command plain. Let's take another screenshot to learn another very important and very dangerous command. And when you do this wrongly or on the wrong path, you'll have to reinstall Ubuntu or you'll lose all your files. So be very careful with this command. So we'll take the screenshot. And we are going to navigate to the path where the screenshot is saved. Ls to list all the files or folders in the current directory. Screenshots are usually saved in the pictures default folder. So we'll open and go into the pictures folder. And we can do ls to list all the files present. We have the folder screenshot in the pictures folder. We open the screenshots folders using cd. Cd screenshots. We are now in the current folder. Then what we do, we can do ls to list all the files present in the screenshot folder, and we can see we have a screenshot in the screenshot folder. We're going to create another directory, another folder called folder 23. Press enter. And we do ls, we can see that the folder is created and we also have the screenshot file. So this command deletes everything in the current path. And it can also delete your Ubuntu image, making your Ubuntu unusable. So when you do sudo ra minus star asterisk, it deletes everything. So when you do ls, we can see we have no file, we have no folder, and we have no screenshot. A very dangerous command. Be very careful with that as a beginner. So we're going to do cd to go back to the root storage, the root path. Next step that you're going to do is you're going to troubleshooting internet problems. Internet in Ubuntu is provided by a wired kind of setup, an Ethernet kind of setup. So you cannot connect to Ubuntu by wireless unless you use a USB adapter. So the first step that you're going to do is you're going to restart our network manager. That's the first thing that you'll do in case you're having problems with your internet. And you're going to restart network manager using this command, sudo systemctl restart network manager. And once you do that, you press enter and wait. Your network should be back after that. If not, this is the next step that you're going to do. We are going to delete the configuration file responsible for internet. And that is, we're going to delete a certain file named resolve.conf. So to delete this file, we do sudo rm for remove, then we state the file path. it should be resolve.conf, not /conf, resolve.conf. A little mistake I made there. Then press enter. I get no such file or directory because I had typed in resolve/conf instead of resolve.conf. After deleting this specific file, we are going to recreate it using the touch command. So we're going to do sudo touch. We're going to delete the rm and do sudo touch. Then resolve.conf. Press enter. We have now created the file. Then we're going to open this file using a text editor software called Nano. So we're going to do sudo. Sudo means as root. Nano, open text file, and we specify the path. Press enter. Your text files should be similar to mine with this contents name server 1.1.1. It will be empty since you had removed it. Make sure it's like that. Then save changes using Control plus X, then Y, then enter. Then you're going to restart systemd resolve the service this way. The next thing you're going to do is reboot. When you reboot, your Wi-Fi should be back and should be working. Now we're going to learn about package management and installation. There are various ways you can install packages. You can install packages using apt. Apt is the most common way of installing packages. So you just do sudo apt install VLC. Let's say if you want to install VLC software. You can also install softwares using snap. So you can do sudo snap install VLC. And to install the VLC software, then you can also install a software or a package using Flatpak. So Flatpak is a software for installing software. So what you do, as a new user, you'll have to install Flatpak using apt. So we do sudo apt install Flatpak. Then after installing Flatpak, we use Flatpak to install a software. Let's say you want to install VLC using Flatpak, we do Flatpak install VLC and VLC will be installed. So this is usually a way to install. There are various ways to install software. It's important because sometimes you might find a software is not available through apt, but it's available through snap or through Flatpak. To uninstall software, you can use the purge command. So if you want to remove VLC, you can do sudo apt purge VLC, and VLC will be uninstalled or removed. We can also remove software, or we can also uninstall software using the rm command. So you can do sudo rm VLC, and that should be able to remove VLC. There's also another way of installing software, of which that's opening your favorite browser and downloading the dev file. Dev file is like the APK version of the application, and then later installing. So here we are going to install Chrome by downloading the Debian file or the Debian format of the software. So we download it and give it time for it to download. Then after downloading, we will navigate to the folder, the downloads folder, which is the default folder for all downloaded files. Then from there, we will be able to install our software. So after downloading the Chrome dev file, we use cd to open the downloads folder and use ls to list all the files present in the downloads folder. You can see that our file has been already present here. So to install Chrome, we can do sudo dpkg minus I, then you copy the name of the Debian file and paste it, then give it some times and the file and the Debian file will be installed. Now once the process is complete, the file has been installed. We can also install dev files using a software called or a package called GDB. So you can install this package called GDB. So we can use then GDB to install Chrome Debian file that we had just downloaded or any other Debian file that you have downloaded. This is important when you need a specific version of a software. Apt usually installs the latest version of a software, but using dpkg or GDB, you can install a specific version of a software. So we just do sudo GDB, copy the name of the Debian file, paste it, and let it run. So our Google Chrome will be installed. Give it a few minutes, and it should be done. So to launch Chrome, we just call it by Google Chrome's table. Some software, you just call them by their name, and you'll be able to launch the software. Google Chrome stable. And now Chrome is launched. Then later you can set up your Chrome. There is usually two graphical user interfaces, and that's GDM and LightDM. To switch between the two, just run this command, sudo dpkg minus reconfigure gdm3. The default one is usually gdm3 when you install Ubuntu, and the other is LightDM. So I will switch to LightDM and press enter. Then I will reboot for changes to take effect. When I reboot, I will be booting into the LightDM display manager, and this is how it appears. So you can log in. Then I'm also going to show you console mode that is booting without any display manager at all. So what you need to do is just reboot. Then at the login screen, you just press Ctrl Alt F2 here. The login screen, Ctrl Alt F2, then input your username, then input your password, and press enter. Now here you have access to the Linux terminal without a graphical user interface. You can update your Ubuntu, you can upgrade your Ubuntu from this, because this is the Linux terminal. Then you can also edit configuration files from here. So in case you're having problems booting Ubuntu, you can just boot without a graphical user interface, then upgrade your system, then reboot, and to see if your problem has been fixed. I'll control C this one, I'll cancel this one using control C. So here we're going to open some files. We're going to do some file management and talk about storage in this section. Connecting USB, viewing files in USB. Yeah. So the first thing that we're going to do, we're going to take this screenshot. And after taking this screenshot, we're going to navigate the file where the screenshot is and try to open the screenshot. So when dealing with files, the first thing that you do, we have this command called cd. Cd is like a command that's used to open folders. or go to. It's like they go to a directory, and you might find this error, no such file or directory. When you find this error, it's usually a common indication that you might be in the wrong folder. So to navigate to the folder where the screenshot was saved, you have to go to CD pictures, go to the folder of pictures using the CD command. Then use the ls command that lists all the files and folders present in a directory. So we have the screenshots folder present in the pictures directory. So to go to the screenshot folders, we use the CD command again to open the screenshots folder. Then we use the ls command to list all the files present in the in this screenshots folder. So to open this screenshot that we have just taken, we have to use this command xdg open. Then we copy the name of the screenshot and paste it, though you may use other software, as you may use even VLC to open screenshots and other softwares that you can download using apt. So you copy and paste it so that you do not get the no such file or directory error. So our screenshot is open. The next thing that you're going to do, we are going to go back to root storage using the CD command. Then we are going to open a bunch of text files. So we have just opened an image using the xdg open. We have navigated, we have placed the files present, and we have opened an image using the command xdg open. Right now what we're going to do, we are going to open configuration files, or we're going to open text files using the software or a package called Nano. So to open a text file, to just do sudo. Sudo means as root. Nano is the software that, sudo means as administrator or as root. Then you use Nano. Nano is the software that opens text files. We have other softwares too that can open text files. We can also open text files using another software called gedit. Gedit requires the graphical user interface to open text files, and it usually has numbers. So when you open a text file, it usually appears with number this way. Then we also have another software or package that can be used to open text files, and that is Vim. So we'll open this file using Vim. You may need to install it. See, I've gotten an error command found. So I'll go ahead and install this command, sudo apt install vim. Then after installing it, I'll be able to open this sources.list text file using the vim command. Give it time for it to install. Then after installing, to open the sources list, which is a text file, you do sudo vim and the path to the file. To quit, you just use colon and q for quit, and you'll be able to quit vim. The next thing you're going to do, you're going to list the drives connected to our machine, to our computer. So you can use this command, sudo fdisk minus I. This one lists all the flash drives and partitions present in our machine. So connect your USB flash drive if you have one. We're going to see all the files present in the flash drive. Then click on devices and click on the USB mass storage. We can see here the, then you can do sudo fdisk minus I minus L, and we can see that our disk drive is present. You can know your disk drive by its size. Mine is 14 GB and its label is SDB. If you have multiple drive, you might have dev SDC, dev SDE. Since they have only one, it's dev SDB. So to view files present in a USB device, we can create a directory using mkdir, mnt, my drive. And we have to create it as administrator or else we'll get errors. Then we have to mount the directory that we have to mount our flash drive using this command mount dev sdb. Sdb is dev sdb is our flash drive. Then we mount the directory that we have just created. When we get super user must be used to mount, you just add sudo. Then we can list all the files present in the directory, my drive, and which are the files present in your flash drive. These are the files present in my USB drive. To eject the flash drive, just do umount. Should be umount. I got an error, so I'll make a spelling correction. And now, doing it as administrator, I will be able to eject my disk drive. You can also deal with files using the Nautilus file manager. So you can go to home, pictures. This is just a graphical user interface way of managing files. Here we're going to talk about the most common errors that beginners experience while installing Ubuntu or while learning how to use Ubuntu. The first error you're going to talk about is the permission denied error. This is also called operation not permitted, or it may come in other forms like you must be super user to run this command, or you might get a question, are you root? So whenever you get this error in this different names or in these forms, what you need to do is just start your command using sudo. Actually, as a beginner, when you attempt to run any command in Ubuntu, begin your command using sudo and you'll be able to solve this permission denied or operation not permitted or super user error. The next error that I'm going to talk about is the no such file or directory. You might be attempting to delete a package or delete a file, then you get the no such file or directory error. The thing about this error is you might be on the wrong path. So here I'm attempting to remove a certain file that does not exist, so I'll get no such file or directory. So when I do sudo rm and set any random file, I'll get the no such file or directory. So you should just check your path and it should be easy for you to solve this error. The next error, common error that I'm going to talk about is the unable to locate package. You might be getting this error as a beginner most of the time. What you need to do when you get the unable to locate package, let's say for example here I'm trying to install the package called Remarkable, then I get the unable to locate package. you might be attempting to install another package, but this will solve most of the problem. When you get the unable to get package, what you need to do as the first thing is open the software properties, software and updates application. You open it from the terminal or from the command line in this way. You just type software properties, GTK. Then what you do is, let's wait for it to open. Ensure all these links here are checked. Ensure you are downloading from the main server and close. After doing that, run sudo apt update. Then go back to attempting to install the package. If you are unable to locate the package again, you need to find other ways to install the package. You can search for the package. Sometimes the package might have changed its name. So you search the package, its new names, with this way, apt-get search, package name. Then you look at the description. You might find that the package changed its name. You can also search the package. You can also solve the unable locate package using another software called apt-file. So what you need to do first is install apt-file with sudo apt install apt-file. Then you do apt-file update as root, or else you'll get this permission denied error. So we will do it as root, sudo apt-file update. And then after running sudo apt-file update, we can be able to search for a missing package or software in this manner. It will take a while if you're doing it for the first time. Since I'm doing it for the second time, it takes a shorter time. So to search for a missing package that I'm attempting to install, I just do apt-file search and put the package name. Wait for a while, you might get a list of names for your package. Then also the next thing that I'm going to talk about is, if you cannot find the file via apt-file search or via apt-get search, you can install the package through snap. As we were attempting to install the package through apt, we found the unable to locate package error. So let's attempt to install this package via snap. And now we can see that we are able to download this remarkable package, which is an editor, which is a text editor using snap. Then you might also have attempted to install a package, then you get an error. So, and you might have also have attempted to remove the package, and then you cannot remove the package and you cannot install it. So this bunch of commands can help you in fixing a broken package. So just run sudo dpkg dash dash configure minus a. Then you can also run sudo apt dash dash fix dash broken install. Then you can also run sudo apt install minus f. Then let's say you want to remove some packages or some software that are not properly installed, or you also want to remove kernel images that you're not using, so you can just do sudo apt auto remove. This will create some space for you, though not a lot, but it will release some space for you and create some space for you. Then there's also a way in which you can install some Windows softwares on Ubuntu. We do that with a package sudo apt install play on Linux. So with this software, after installing it, with the command sudo apt play on Linux, we will be able to run some Windows softwares on Ubuntu. Just wait for the download to finish, then run the command play on Linux, and you'll be able to use some Windows softwares. Thank you.